Hey guys, this is Vineet. I'm one of the engineers here at Advanced Thermal Solutions. And today we're going to talk about heat pipes and their effective thermal conductivity. This is in Qpedia issue 96. It's one of the articles, and you can follow along with that. So here in my hands, I have two samples of heat pipes. One of them is a curved one. It's a curved flat one. The other one is kind of opened up here so you can see the sintered, the wicking structure on the inside, and this is kind of what that looks like. If you look at our data sheets on our website at qats.com, you'll see that for heat pipes, generally the data sheets mention the maximum power, effective length, operating temperature, etc., etc. But it's not going to mention thermal conductivity or thermal resistance, and that's true for industry. And the reason is, you know, heat pipes are heat transfer pieces. They're used to transfer from hot side to cold side. They're not dissipating any heat, and so generally most people just treat this as, you know, you put that in on one side and heat goes from one side to the other. But there is a temperature drop associated with it, and in certain key and critical applications it becomes important to measure it. So today we're gonna talk about just some basic fundamentals on how you can measure that. So here we have just a 2D cross-section of the heat pipe. On the outside you have the casing, so generally that's copper, but it could be anything else. On the inside here you have your wicking structure. And over here you have your vapor space. So generally when you if you've heard about how heat pipes have very high conductivity, that's true compared to, you know, solid metals. But if you, when you vert absurd numbers, you're talking about the vapor space here. In this vapor space, the thermal conductivity, the effective thermal conductivity is so high that you, as we'll see, you basically assume that there's no temperature drop across there. But there is a temperature drop associated with the heat transfer going to the vapor space and coming out of there. So what we'll do is we'll start off, let me erase this here, we'll start off with, if you have a hot surface here, so we'll call this your T hot, this is your evaporator section, and this is your T cold, this is your condenser section. So immediately you can see that there's a resistance of the case, so whatever this copper casing, you're going to have some resistance here, and then you're going to have radial resistance going this way as well. Then this goes into this temperature of the vapor space, so let's say TV, and axial resistance of that. You end up with your TVC, let's call it. And again, same thing going back down this way. So you have a resistance coming back out, and then a resistance again in the case. So while that's happening, also some of the heat does get leaked through on this end as well. It leaks through on the casing and it leaks through, so to speak, axially on the wicking structure. So you have a relatively complicated resistance network that actually gets simplified pretty quickly. So I know I've used some other nomenclature here, but if you follow along with the article, you'll see, I'll try to use the same nomenclature as the article in the equations that I'm about to write. All right, so before I go into this, the big equation, let me just touch upon some fundamentals. As you know, the resistance concept and heat transfer works the same way as it works in electricity. So if I have my T hot here and two resistors and T cold, then in order to combine these resistance, my R total would be R1 plus R2. If, for instance, they were in parallel, then the total would be 1 over RT is 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2. So it's, you have to use a combination of these, and we'll use that to basically come up with a final version of the equation that includes all of the resistors together. So the way we do that in this is we'd have to go from the middle down this way. So if you have, let me start off here. So if you have your resistance of the vapor, your axial resistance, and then the radial resistance through the condenser and the radial resistance of the brick structure through the evaporator. And this is the axial resistance in the wick structure. So you have this network here. What you'd want to do is combine these three into parallel first, because you know finally the heat is transferring this way. So combine these three, in series. Combine these three in series, and then that'll become one resistance. This will be some, you know, some total RTC, let's call it, and you'll keep the RAW in here. So you keep combining resistances down the line, and that's how we end up with equation one. Let's step into the framework. One! So this is equation one, as you can see in the article. That includes, so we've combined all the resistances into one R total. And the way we'll end up simplifying this, there's two ways we'll end up simplifying it. One, as I've been saying, the resistance in the vapor space is basically nothing. It's 10 to the minus 8 degrees C per watt. So if this goes to zero, okay, then this whole thing will go to zero. And the resistance, the radial resistance in this direction, you know, in the evaporator is the same as in the condenser. So you can combine those as well. And so when that, with that said, your final equation will end up being very simple. It's just the radial resistance of the pipe in the evaporator and the radial resistance of the wick. Actually, I should get rid of the evaporator. It's we combine that, that's where the two comes from. In the condenser and the evaporator, it's symmetric. And so that's what you end up with. So the lesson being that really the biggest resistances are, you know, even these leakages are super, are not as important. So the biggest resistances are these radial portions right there. All right, guys, so there you have it. The final equation shows, like I said, what's important is the axial portion. It depends on, you know, what your heat pipe is made out of. If you're choosing some material that's not as conductive as copper, it's going to have an effect on how the effect of thermal conductivity of your heat pipe. If you have a wick structure that's mesh, and that's the example that was used in the article, you're not going to have the very, very high thermal conductivity that people expect out of a heat pipe. In the example that was used in the article, using a 500 mesh, the final thermal conductivity was somewhere in the range of 700s, which was still pretty good, which is still much better than even copper, solid copper, for example. But it's you have to be careful about using that in the application. Make sure that it's the right fit for it.